Welcome to talk.cyberCNI.fr.
Bienvenue.
Welcome everybody to the speaker series. The speaker series is co-organized by the chair CyberCNI at IMT Atlantique, together with the Pôle Excellence Cyber et la Région Bretagne. The speaker series Talk CyberCNI is about the cybersecurity and why is cybersecurity relevant for us? Because especially with the Corona crisis, we have seen that we have lots of systems surrounding us that are automated, distributed, driven by computers, and all these systems are connected to the internet. And in the internet, we have lots of attack potential, so lots of threats, lots of malware, lots of things that can happen with the infrastructures. And you know, when the internet goes down, you already have trouble. But when you think about the water supply or the electricity supply, the transport, banking, healthcare, food production, telecommunication, of course, all these things rely on cyber systems, so working software systems. With the CyberCNI talk series, we want to shine some light on different aspects of the cybersecurity, because this is a super important aspect of today's digital society. I do not want to tell too much at the beginning. I want to leave the room and the floor directly to our first speaker today, which is Frédéric Jules, the CEO from Airbus Cybersecurity. On the bottom right, you see all the partners of the chair with Airbus, Amosus, BNP Paribas, EDF, Nokia, and Pôle Excellence Cyber, and also Région Bretagne. And I'm very happy to welcome Frédéric today for our series.
Hello everybody, so I'm the CEO of Airbus Cybersecurity SAS in France. In addition, I am the head of the principal programs of cybersecurity for also Germany and UK in Airbus. So, thank you very much for hosting this talk. And I have prepared, in order to be more efficient and perhaps for all of you, it will be easier to follow. We have prepared a few slides for the chairman. For those who should leave before the end, you can also contact me directly or via Marc Olivier. Okay? So let's begin with just the agenda. So the idea is for me to present, to introduce quickly Airbus Cybersecurity, what we have to do in order also to set the scene of the environment and the main challenges that that we have. And after, we will tackle two challenges. The first one is how to train cyber experts, because we are missing a lot of them. We need more and more experts. I will come back to this. And the second one is how to innovate, and in particular, to link with the academic partners. And then I will just finish, because I think it could be of interest, especially for the students that are listening, with a quick overview of the main cyber expertises. You will see that there are many of them. As Marc-Olivier said, at the end, we can take questions. So let's go first with this introduction. So it's a few words in order to explain what we are doing in Airbus Cybersecurity. So first of all, we'll do a bit of strategy. It is to explain what is our approach for cybersecurity. We try and we do detect and protect against attacks, and in particular against APT, advanced persistent threat, which are very difficult to detect and can really cause damage. And we have decided in terms of strategy in the group that the best way to do it is to protect our own group, Airbus, defense and government bodies, and that's why in France, but not only in France, we protect the French MOD. We protect also in Germany and in UK the MODs, and more in Spain, and also the CNIs. only because it's very simple, the groups of attackants that we know, they can move from one target to another. Some of them are only driven by politics, but most of them are very open and they can move very quickly. And it's very powerful when you are able to protect the three different segments, which is our case, and it's a bit rare on the market. Many providers are not limited, but focused on one segment. So here on the right, you can see typically the CNIs, and I will come back to this in the presentation and in the discussion with you. So now, if we go to the setup, we are a company, Airbus, that you know, with 130,000 employees, so that's a lot, and almost 1% are cyber. It's 900, so not a small number. And if you speak about the number of experts, cyber is already a big organization. We are mainly, even if there are 30 nationalities, we are mainly in France, Germany, and UK. We are 500 in France, over the 900, and then almost balanced between UK, a bit more in UK, 200, and the rest in Germany, a bit in the Middle East and in Spain, but it's smaller. So we have really a European setup, which is important, you will see later. We have, for example, an important European contract where we protect Conseil de l'Europe, so 17 institutions of Europe. It's very important for us to work on innovation. That's why I think we are here with Marc Olivier, the chair CNI, and so on. Very important for us. So we are also working quite a lot in order to capture R&D budget. And there are a lot of R&D budget at the European level, for your information. So it's an important part of our strategy. In order to innovate, we need also some budget and we go there. And I will have the occasion to give some examples. And we have also R&D investment. It's really Airbus thing. Airbus is capable when it's important to build engineering from Europe by investing. So we invest also a bit in order to develop new things. But it's not enough to have a European setup and some budget. We need partners, we need links with academics, and it's really what I want to show. So now, because we are for the call, we are not limited to France, but I wanted to do a small zoom on France just for to explain the setup in this country. We are mainly close to Paris, in Elancourt, where we are more than 200 people, and from there we can address the three sectors I discussed: the MOD, the defense, the private sector, the CNIs, and Airbus Group. In Rennes, we have an agency because the MOD, as probably you know for the French people, MOD and the government has created the Pôle d'Excellence Cyber in Brittany, and there are many things to do, and that's why also we have so many links with EMT Atlantic and other schools there. And, well, we are Airbus, so we are also in Toulouse with an agency of Airbus Cyber in Toulouse in order to do services mainly for aircraft. And after, we can serve people everywhere, but it's important because of the main areas of what I wanted to show there. And then if I continue with a quick presentation of our company, and what we propose, it is something that could be interesting, I think, for you also in order to prepare the discussion about the expertise. In order to protect a customer or ourselves, we have to be able, so it's in French, but I will explain. We have to be able to do a kind of life cycle of cyber protection. First of all, it is prevention, where we have to be able to do audits, consulting, in order pen test, in order to see if it's well protected, and to give advice, propose things to do better. And it's really services which are oriented on kind of consulting, and also homologation and so on. But it's one part of what we do. Then often services companies are not providing the second part, which is the protection. Protection, it's a matter of architecture or integration. So let's say you have an IT system or a production system on an assembly line, and in fact, you have to protect it. So here you need architects who are able to gather solutions, integrate them, and be at the very top edge of the architecture in cyber, but also understand the architecture in which the cybersecurity has to operate. So it's not a small thing. It's probably one half of our teams today are working on protection. And then as the protection is not enough, we have to be able to detect if there is an attack. So it is the role of the SOC, the Security Operational Centers. And this we have in several countries in Europe, and especially one in Elancourt. I will come back in a minute on that. So it's not only detection, it's also all the threat intelligence analysis, all you have to do in order to be very accurate in detection. And fourth part, it is the capability to react. So it's also a cyber expertise. It's where you have to be able to do incident response. You have to be able to do forensics and even to repair, in fact, to fix issues, and so it's also services. And it's a life cycle because all customers, all of us, we have extensions of perimeters, we have new partners on an assembly line. You can have a subcontractor coming with a PC and connecting it to your network. It's new, so it's a new threat. So you have to continue to do consulting and so on. So it's really circle virtual, I don't know in English, but something that you have to do regularly in order to make sure that you protect correctly and as much as possible. So here, just a very quick word about the SOC. It's a picture of our Security Operations Center, where we deliver managed services to 30 companies, plus our own company, and where you have a first line with people surveying and a lot of experts, around probably between 60 and 100 operating the security. So just it's the end of the quick presentation of Airbus Cybersecurity, just to show that the panel of expertise is very broad. There are many things to do. So we have quite challenges. Typically, one of the main challenges is that the surface of attack is growing each hour, and we need more and more trained cyber experts. So for that, we had an idea a few time ago. It is that we could have a way to simulate the networks that could be attacked, but also the way of attacks. And this could be in what we call a cyber range and could help to train our own experts. So it was a few time ago. And we began like that. And we discovered on the road that it was very useful for many other things, for tests, for training of experts outside of Airbus, typically with academics, and to simulate environments at large. So I will spend a few time to explain because I think it's one of the topics I think I would like to share with you today. Just to show you what is this cyber range that we use and that we deliver and propose to academics and to customers in general. So it's a versatile platform. That means it's a multi-role platform. It can do many things. All is about cyber, but many things. There is a list here that we will follow. First of all, it's able to do a modeling of real systems. So typically, what is difficult if you want to innovate, it is to innovate and check on a real system. It's very difficult because operational systems and so on, you cannot just play with them. So it's very important to be able to model them. And it's one of the main characteristics this avalanche. Then you have also to have something very open where you can do hybrid technology. You can link also with the real systems. So you will see later we have examples of that, and it's really really important. After you are in the cyber launch, it's important that you can automatically generate scenarios. So this cyber launch is able to elaborate an IT or an OT network plus scenarios of something which will happen, and in particular, a set of configurable attacks. And here, something I've not said alone enough. Why is it interesting to share this kind of things with academics? Because in fact, our people, 200 and more people, who are defending on a daily basis, they see the new attacks. So we have in permanence the last IOC, the last attacks, and we are able to have something which is updated. And also, we when we do pen test, we also generate some new ideas. So altogether, it's something which is maintained up to date for us and for the academics. And then we have also there is a backup on a way to deploy topologies, and it's a collaborative tool. So I'm not presenting it to sell it. It's really to share the techno and why we have developed it here. So let's continue to not spend too much time on it, on this first part. I will go quickly on other solutions, innovative solutions that we create and where we need experts, the cyber range, but also we have IAM, innovative tool. We have Orion. I will not take too much time on this one. Orion, which is a malware detection tool. Automatically, you put a malware inside. It plays with it and it extracts a report, and much more than a report. So it's a very useful one. We insist on this one. And we have, for example, secure gateways, which are also at the top of the expertise for today. So it's just to explain that for Airbus Cyber, it's not only important to have services, but we need also innovative solutions. Then coming back to the cyber range, on this picture, you can see something which is very important. Just drawings, but it's very important for us. Cybersecurity is a matter of expertise in cyber. For one part, you have to be very good in IT or OT and understanding the attacks. So there are many expertises, but it's really a technical domain with digitalization and so on. But if you have only that, you are not doing a good work for your customers, because you need also to have the link with the domain where they work. Because there are some very powerful attacks which can do nothing in an environment, and very simple attacks which can really do something very, very damageable. So what is important is to have, and that's what we try to do, and it's one of the roles of the cyber launch, to have a close link between the cybersecurity expertise that are needed and the domains where the customers are. Let's say healthcare, or energy, or transportation. So it's very important to link the two, and it's what we do with cyber launch. So if I go on the on this slide, it's just to show where we are with the academics. So here it is a zoom on the link with academics, because we use cyber launch in other contexts. When you see a purple flag with a city or a school, it's because the engineering school or the engineer school is using a cyber launch for its cyber security training. So you see that we're a lot in Brittany for the reasons I have mentioned that before, but we have more and more all over in France. And for your information, we are more and more also in Germany and also in UK now since last year. So Cyberwarns that were developed here is more and more used on a larger scale. And when it's green, it's because it's manageable from distance from these areas. And last point on the cyber launch, which is again here, I zoom especially not on the test part but on the training part. We have developed a partnership with a company, which is a startup in fact, its name is Scylla. And we associate in fact our industrial cyber launch with a lot of people gathering expertise inside to a startup. With a value added, which is important for us, is digital training. So they have very advanced ways of deliver trainings. And we, it's not our our expertise, so we link with them. And Scylla is able to train with our CyberRange many people. It's an open way of training. So. Here, my main topic was about how to train cyber experts and the way one company can help academics, in fact, and it's a story of partnership. And I will continue with partnership with some examples that we have built around around the link with IMT Atlantic and CNI share and so on. So first of all, first introduction on these partnerships, just to insist on the fact that collaboration is very important in cyber. It's really difficult to be at the edge of the expertise if you are alone. It's impossible, in fact, and it's probably one of the main of the domains where collaboration is the more important. It's important for the customer to share the information with their security agency, like NC in France. It's important for the providers of services or solutions, because you cannot alone protect. And it's important also through the link with students or people of the share CNI of who are really looking for new solutions, and it's very important for us. So it is something we develop more and more, and our innovation team is linked on a daily basis with a lot of people of academics in many domains. Then the second part is just to recall that this R&D innovation targets can be done through the cyber launch, but other ways. And that today, for us, we have a collaborative development with more than 190 partners. So just to illustrate this importance of being a lot all together, and with 42 organizations. And it's not only in one country. The base is mainly Europe, Italy, Greece, Germany, and so on. But it's there is no frontiers for this cooperation. We really have to work internationally. And we are working, as I said, not only in cyber expertise, but in domains. And we are involved in more than 10 types of environments. And I will just illustrate some of them in order for you to have a better understanding of what we do. So here I'm not presenting projects or programs that we deliver to customers, but some innovative projects that we develop in an R&D environment. So typically, this one is about healthcare. So we develop it with 21 partners in Europe, Airbus Cyber plus 21 partners, plus 20 partners, and in particular, three European hospitals. So one of them is in France, it is the one of Marseille, but we have others in other countries. And what we do is that we work with, again, it is a link between the cybersecurity expert and the people who know the domain. So we work with people from the hospital, and we have developed 12 scenarios. And these scenarios, for example, is to identify that if you have a security breach with somebody inside the hospital and a digital breach with, I don't know, a USB key or something entering is not at the right place. Isolated, it's not a huge issue, but the two together, it's a use case which could really create an issue. So it's typically this kind of scenario that we build, and we build also the solutions in order to detect these risks and be able to warn the users and the owners of the hospitals and so on, and also contain the attack. So it's very important that we have this. So here also we use our CyberLunch in order to simulate the healthcare infrastructure because attacking and testing the real one is just not possible and not recommended. So another example, just to be very practical and concrete, it is the airport. Here it's another program, European program, SATI, in which we each of them is a competition that we had to win, in fact, in order to have a European budget. So SATI is another one that we have won with 18 partners. And this time it's three European airports, which are part of the consortium. And the domain is different, it's airport, but there is also another difference. It is that here it's possible to link the airport infrastructure simulated by the CyberLunch to real systems. So typically we can connect to baggage and link systems and just show that with certain scenarios, if we change the route of a baggage, we can do things which are very damageable for the airport and so on. And it seems not a big thing in terms of technical expertise, but in fact, in terms of effect, it can be a real lot. And this is typically another sector where we work and we innovate. And then the two first ones, I will finish with this one. The two first ones were cases where you are simulating attacks on solutions and detection on a real operational on operational assets, an hospital, an airport. This one's different. Sequoia is another project, where in fact we have to protect the assembly line, the production line, and in three domains that you can see here: aerospace, maritime, and automotive. And it's another kind of consortium with 12 partners, but we have to develop innovative solutions in order to protect these production lines against attacks. And we have developed capabilities, not alone, but with our partners, and it's true also for the others. It's always a partnering job. So, but again, on the same principles, which are, and it was what I wanted also to show, which are to link cyber expertise with domain, and it's where if you do so, you are good, you are efficient, because, and it's true. For many cases, you can imagine, for example, the Security Operations Center. You have to survey in live against attacks a very vast domain of customer. You have sensors and you have detection strategies that you position on your sensor, and you have 8/24, 7 days per week people waiting for the filters to let the alarm come to them, and then studying if it is a real attack or not. If we are looking only for the same attacks for all type of customers, we will just lose miss the job, because we have to be aware also of the attacks which are built for a specific effect on a specific customer. And this is also the big interest of cybersecurity. It's really the link between digitalization and a variety of domains. And this we have learned in Airbus with our first customers, which were military, but we develop it at large with partners. And we do not try to do everything, but we try to do efficiently the things that we do. And for this, we need partners, academics, and so on. And we need tools to share like Sabrina, genre over to Sabrina, je les écoute exemple. I hope I have a bit clarified the way we try to train new cyber experts, but also to find and to build innovation with partners using this CyberRange tool. Then, we are discussing also in an academic setup, even if probably there are not only academic people or students, just wanting to show a slide which I said in advance. There are many things in it, but and probably it's small, especially if you are looking on your phone. But it's in relationship with what I said here. It's only the main expertise domain of engineering in our company for what we do, and we are only 900 people, and we don't do everything. We do only one part, which we consider as important for us. We protect our group, we protect CNIs, some CNIs, and the defense of our own countries. So you can see on the left, it's mainly the program part, that is architect integrator, as we discussed just before. And on the right, it's more the services way of doing things. So keep it short, you have more architecture and integration on the left, and you have more consulting, auditing in general, pen test, and so on. Right. So, in order to be able to do things correctly, you need system engineering, with system architects, system design authorities, in a variety of domains. So, digital, test, mechanical, assembly, and so on. And it's only one part of the domains. You need software skills, Pierce software skills, in terms of software engineers at different levels. The upper you go, the most experienced people are. You need validation skills. It can be a generic validation skills, but you need also a good understanding of the cybersecurity in order to be efficient in validation. So it's also the possibility of important validation. It's important, and there is not only the research of new attacks. It's very important. Architecture, of course, cybersecurity architects from beginning to senior, and then integration skills, system administration skills, security operation center skills, incident response. Evaluation, that means pen tester, what we call evaluation, is mainly pen tester, from junior to confirmed senior vulnerability searcher, and consultancy, which is a bit wider. So just to give a sense of the variety of expertise that you need in a team in order to be able to do the four-step life cycle I was presenting just before. And again, we need to do this specifically for domains that we understand, where we have link with people who understand, who are able to explain to us what is important and what is less important. So that's why we need more and more experts in these different cases, and we need to innovate. To innovate a lot all together. So it was just a way to present a bit the way we train, the way we innovate, and I'm ready, Marc-Olivier, for answering questions if you have.
Perfect. Thank you very much. Let me just shrink the image here a little bit so that in the stream the people can see us properly. Okay. Good. Frederik, thank you very much for the wonderful presentation with lots of important aspects in it. So we also have lots of questions already, and this is quite good. So you see that your talk stimulated the audience. But I would start. So who would you say should have knowledge in cybersecurity?
What do you mean by who?
By who, I mean, so yeah, I can elaborate a little bit. So I personally would say cybersecurity is a key competency that you need today for a living. And that for me would mean that we should even go into schools. We should at least go to universities so that everybody has it in the parkour and so on. So do you share this opinion or do you have a different opinion?
Oh, yes, I share. I share for several reasons. Because in general, we need that. Because I think cybersecurity is not known enough, and it's really an interesting career that we should tackle early in the scholarship. But also, in order to have more women and ladies in general joining the cybersecurity expertise, because we have a lot to do. Because in terms of capabilities, a lot of people could join the cybersecurity. Orientation and don't do because they do not know what it is. They do not know how interesting it is, how various are the activities. And that's what I try to show. Already in the scope of cybersecurity engineering, you have a lot to do, but you have also program management, marketing, sales. It's just an incredible domain. And again, it's a technical domain, digitalization, which is at the closest of the operational domains, and it's what really is fascinating. So we should go. I don't know when our kids are 12 or 13, and explain that with people who are able to explain that, and with some of our very good also ladies experts, in order for them to also to promote what can be a career in this field.
Yeah.
Yes, we have a lot to do.
Yeah, very good. And I really like this approach of saying that. And the cyber range is also the perfect tool for it because you can experiment in it and you cannot destroy much because it's virtualized. So that means you can really do experimentation. You can do instantiation of different things and so on. But we'll have more questions to that. A second question, also a very difficult one. What is the most important competency towards cybersecurity that you would say people should have?
Of course, there are technical competencies, but as we've seen, there is a variety of them. I think in you have to be prepared to be surprised. Uh-huh. So you have to be very open-minded because things are changing a lot. So in fact, it's typically a domain where when you enter it, it's because you know you will change, evolve. You will have evolution in your knowledge, in what you will do. And well, for me, it's a plus, but
yes.
people have to like that, and it's true for technical positions, but also for management, because I'm more on the management side for a while, more technical before, and I can say to you, when you are a manager in cybersecurity, everything is moving, even the partnerships, the Campus Cyber created right now, so things are changing everywhere every time.
Very good answer. And also this pre-prepared for the change is the best answer you can give. So thank you very much for that.
It was not prepared.
Yeah, very, very good. So I hand over to Alex, who is managing the chat. Alex is a postdoc with us at the chair. And
Hi. Okay, so there were some questions about several topics, so I will try to regroup them. First kind of questions were about the number of incidents detected per day in relation also to the corona pandemic. So I will just cite the questions. Can you give us an idea of the number of incidents detected per day? Did the severity of incidents increase during the corona pandemic? And the second one on the same topic was, I have to find it, sorry. Yeah, it was about the same thing. So it was, did the corona pandemic increases your activity on incident management?
Well, for the number, so the global number all over for everybody is a lot. For us, we cannot give detailed information because to protect okay. Information, but what is sure, and this I can attest, is that healthcare hospitals and so on have been much more attacked during this period. That's why the government, we all participated as much as we could to protect. So it was also depending either you had a customer which was an hospital or not. Huh? But the other way of answering is that because of this important number of attacks, the French government has decided to have a plan de relance, specific budget, huh, even if there are many things to put as a budget today, huh, not only, but which has been decided very recently and which is really close to healthcare and to this domain. So it is a point of attention in order to, because of what occurred, to be better in protecting this domain.
Okay, so there is a question. I will just continue with that, with the healthcare data. So the question was, how do you safeguard the data security of the medical files during the use of the cyber range in the use case of the hospital? So again, can you give a specific answer?
Sorry, I was on mute. Can you just repeat the question, please?
Yeah. It was a question about the how do you safeguard the data security of the medical files during the use of the cyber range in the use case of the hospital?
Safeguard the data of the hospital. So I'm not sure we had real data from the hospital for the simulation.
I assume that the question arises when you presented a use case with the cyber.
Yes, with on safe care. Yes, but we don't need to manipulate the real data. It's per principle. We have the good understanding of the IT and OT of the hospitals. We have the good understanding of what could hurt. Where are the data? But the data themselves can be. False data, and it's by the way, it is the case for
today. So, okay. So there were another two questions related to the cyber range, and I will skip to another topic. So, did the COVID-19 crisis affect the way you advertise the cyber range and its features? Did you have to adapt anything for its remote use? And the second one, which is related, what are not so much related though. What are the industrial capabilities of the cyber range? Can PLCs be virtualized the same way Linux or Windows computers are?
So for the first one, the cyber range is existing as a solution, standalone solution. But we had also anticipated, and that's good for the COVID effect, and because we had anticipated with a cloud solution. So it's possible also to have services of the cyber range from distance. So what has changed with COVID is that the cloud usage has increased exponentially. We have many requests, but we could adapt, so it's not an issue. We even used our cyber range in order to work from distance for our own employees. Because when COVID in March last year, 70% of our engineers were at home, but 30% had to come because they were on critical systems, they had to be in the office. We tried to optimize the number that were able to be in a remote, in home office. And CyberRange was useful for that. So CyberRange, two answers. We continue to develop the features to be more efficient in cloud. We had more requests. And we used also CyberRange for our own developments on some topics, and even the developments of colleagues of Airbus. So it's a usage that we did not have planned in advance.
So maybe let me kick in here, if I may. So you showed this nice interface with the 3D visualization of this chemical plant. And so now if I'm a chemical company and I want to use the cyber range to test what I'm doing, or if I'm a hospital that wants to test something, so how do I get my configuration in? So what would be the concrete process? What is happening there? And is it difficult? Is it easy to do? What would happen there?
No, so it's... It's easy because you can easily simulate your IT. You can put hundreds of workstations. And you can add every servers and so on. And so if you have a good knowledge of your architecture as a customer, it's easy because you can simulate it easily. If you don't have a good knowledge of the attacks, you will use what we provide, all the attacks. And after you can play with that. You can build scenarios and so on. And also, I spoke about collaboration, and collaboration is always there. So, of course, an academic or a customer can use the CyberRange alone, but most of the time, it's not the way we work. There are regular work together with our experts in order to adapt and be very close to the needs of the academics of the customer in terms of scenario of scenarios of attacks. So it's a common work in order to develop, but a lot of things can be done alone. I hope I answered. And it's very simple, and it's graphic. So you can take a variety of a kind of elements of your network, and you put it on the graph. You take an attack in a library of attacks, and you send it, and you see what occurs.
Yeah, exactly. Because if people did not use it yet, so it's really, as Frederick just said, so you can really drag and drop different services. You can say you have this DHCP service, you drop it in, you connect it, and then it's working. And the good thing is that it's the real entities that are running in an emulation there. And therefore you have the realistic data and everything.
I will give another example, if I may, because it's something I think it's not for the training, but it's for the test. Mm-hmm. Because I think what is also powerful is the test capabilities of such a tool. For example, a few years already ago, perhaps 1 or 2 years ago, we had a request from a customer in order to have a benchmark of all the sensors, the IDS for OT. You know, because we have a lot of sensors for IT. I will not give any trademark, but for OT, it was not so well known if the American ones were better than Israeli or European. So we took all of them and we simulated the attacks with the CyberRange. And so it's very important, this test capability. And I will give another example. The CyberRange can be used also to test an innovation. And this, I think, is very powerful. For example, in the Campus Cyber, we not touch much on the Campus Cyber, but the Campus Cyber ID is to have partners, but also competitors working together. Today, when you have a small company with a good ID, the small company is a bit alone because there are five very good engineers with their solution, and they go to see big companies like Airbus or Thales or Safran or I don't know, and Cisco, and they ask for a proof of concept. And they spend 6 months, 1 year, 18 months to answer questions. And they are till the 3 or 5 people. Huh? So they spend all the time answering questions. And after the 1 year, they can have a very, very positive feedback, but it's a technical feedback, and they are still not in the Gartner. So it's not proven that their solution will be bought by the companies. So it's a weakness in France and perhaps in Europe. And CyberLaunch is also very efficient for that. And if, for example, we decide all together in a campus that we will test only once, and then the report can be accessible to a variety of customers or partners, it's completely different. And it seems very simple, but nobody's doing that. So this kind of simulation tools, if we share that, it's not again to sell it, it's really to say there are many benefits from it if you use it in a collaborative way.
Would you say that the CyberRange improved your communication also with the customers, because you can now try it out and show them directly without destroying something, and also in large scale with the attacks and so on? So is it an important tool that pushed also your core business of cybersecurity, having this besides the teaching aspect?
Yes, for us it's important to show scenarios and so on, but it's also important to show our understanding of what I tried to explain is that we strongly believe that we need expertise in cyber close to a good understanding of the domains of activity of our customers. And the CyberEng is really a tool to illustrate that. And I think customers in general they appreciate to see that it's really per construction what we try to do. To avoid to have only positive attacks, not false positive, but positive attacks with no real risk for them. When you buy a surveillance, a SOC surveillance, you want to make sure that the surveillance is adapted to your needs. And if you provide a CyberEng, that means that it's really a topic which is important for you.
Uh-huh. And this is also an aspect that we will explore together in the effort that we started at the European Cyber Week of having a cyber range setup that we put in as a honeypot for doing real attack observations and so on, which will definitely be very interesting to do.
Yes, probably yes. I hope we'll have ECW.
Yeah. Okay, so Alex, next question.
Okay. So the question most liked was about the fact that cybersecurity is a team game. Could you say a few words on what initiatives do you have to build security awareness for engineers and developers?
So we have specific communications. So inside the group, and also we even have an offer of awareness. Because it's very important for engineers, for developers, for managers also. So it's clearly a topic. So we have other means than CyberEng to do awareness, and because you can also have a straightforward communication with a bit of a sense of humor, with a bit of practical examples where the people, they catch the importance of cybersecurity. So if you speak about awareness, there are several ways of doing it, and we do other ways. But with CyberEng, we organize awareness nights. So it's not full nights, but soirée awareness. And where the people, they just arrive, and at the beginning, they can be SecureCom or a communication engineer, not CyberEng. They arrive, and in a few hours, and I did it by myself, they will take the control of the workstation of their neighbor. And just by manipulating with the CyberEng a few vulnerabilities, which are standard ones. And for having done it by myself, really, it's impressive. And when you have done that, you believe that, yes, if you are well organized, using two or three vulnerabilities in a row, you can do really, can take control. You can do things which can be really damageable for the companies. So, and this is, I think, one way of awareness.
Okay. And to complete this question, where it is. Yeah. Do you use cyber threat intelligence to provide real life scenarios on your CyberEng?
If we use, sorry?
Cyber threat intelligence.
Yes. Yes. In fact, I did not perhaps use the term often. I said it only once, I think, in the past hour. Okay. But threat intelligence is a key part of cybersecurity. Threat intelligence is typically something that you normally analyze per domain, because the threat report that we prepare for our customers are dedicated to their domain, industry, transportation, and so on. It depends on the domain, and it's very important. And this, again, we are doing it with tools of the market, because we are also buying tools on the market, plus with our own experts.
Okay. More technical questions now. Do you use any particular method or framework in order to do incident response?
Um, So incident response we use, for example, Orion, the tool I discussed just before, in order to analyze the malware and what they can do. We have a bunch of tools, in fact, that we use, and also processes. We have sandboxes. For example, Orion is as a sandbox. So it's and I don't know for the person who asked. So we have our own ways of doing things, and there are also now standards. For example, ANSI is asking in order to be at the level of prestataire de réponse à incident, there is a level to reach, and so it's for the French part, but it's a sum of good practices and so on that you have to demonstrate in order to be pre- so we are not, because today most people are in the route to be pre- the companies, but it's again, it's really réponse à incident. Incident response is a domain which is structured, organized with tools, with processes, with expertise. It's a domain in itself.
Okay. We just make a small jump about around the previous questions, which was about the awareness. So the author completed it by putting a follow-up question. He meant that can the cyber range to be used by non-cyber engineers like software developers?
So yes, the answer is yes. It can be used to develop more expertise, but it can also be used to have something close to you with cyber knowledge inside the cyber range that you can use when you are not a cyber expert. So okay. Yes, and here, I would recommend that it's used in a cloud manner if it's only that, because to avoid to be efficient and not use too many means.
Okay, so there was a small question about malware detection. What kind of detection models do you use in your cases?
Dynamic and static. So we have two. So it's complementary models in order to make a full assessment.
Okay, nice. Another question. Thank you for the presentation. What cybersecurity standards do you use at Airbus? Is there any cybersecurity training that you will recommend?
Cybersecurity training, the cyber range one. No, there are so many domains. My answer would be more that I think you cannot, if you want really to be secure or to secure, you cannot focus to only one. So it's more an assembly of domains. So I'm not answering exactly the question, but it's because there are so many domains, but. MOC from ANSI, for example, could help.
Okay, and I think it's the last one from now. So it is a more tedious question. Would you say that France is still in the race of cybersecurity in the light of the SolarWinds scandal? So this was actually now the most liked question we had.
Well, it's not because you have one event that you have to depress. If you give a look, I try to not be too French, but if you give a look to the competition and so on, I think in France we have quite a lot, but in Europe in general, because we have quite a lot of cyber capabilities, and if we manage to perhaps partner more. Because the issue of cybersecurity, it's interesting, but the difficulty, the additional difficulty is the sovereignty. If you live outside of Europe for a while, you will see It's impressive how we are European, but also speaking. So the way we do our research, innovation, especially in cyber, is very fragmented per country. So so it's clear that we could do better by sharing more in this field. But the capabilities of providing cybersecurity are there. It is how to go to the scale, to the world scale, where we are not good at. In general, but there are some exceptions, I'm sure. So that's why typically the Campus Cyber launched by the French government, or I hope the European one a bit later, are really the right direction, because we have to use international solutions without complete control on them when we have not the scale, in fact. And what we should work on, and we do, and it's one of the jobs of Airbus Cyber, is to be more and more able to be in control, perhaps not of all the solutions, but at least of the glue which is in between the solutions, and also to provide some of the worldwide solutions. And if we do so, we will have less scandals and less issues, and we have all the capabilities to do so.
Okay.
In France.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you for your answers. I think I will. I don't have more questions, so I can. Okay. Yeah, maybe. Your microphone is cut down, Mark Oliver.
Yes, sorry. Mark Oliver, we can... Yeah, thanks. Yeah. Thank you very much. Yeah, great. So maybe if people have more questions, you have still time to put it. In the meantime, let me ask one question. Would you say that the awareness of cybersecurity increased due to the confinement and the people depending more on the IT tech, on the IT and OT, or would you say it's still, the relation is still unclear?
Between IT and OT, you mean?
No. The relevance of cybersecurity. So the relation between outages and cybersecurity threats. This is the relation that I meant.
This one, I'm not sure, Marc-Olivier.
The question is, do you think the awareness of the relevance of cybersecurity increased
yes.
due to COVID?
Oh, yes. In fact, it's, yes, because I think yes and no. Because at the very beginning, when the confinement has begun, there was a necessity to go quick and be able to work from distance. So cybersecurity topics were in the mindset, but at the same time, some companies had to go very fast. And there have been some not very good decisions taken, but just because we had to work. But it was really for a few times. And right after, a lot of efforts have been made, I think, by everybody, but also the cybersecurity community, in order to increase our footprint. And for the companies, it has shown the importance of cybersecurity. I will give an example. Some companies did not have the right level of cybersecurity firewalls or capabilities and so on, because they did not. They never had an equivalent to the confinement. And with the confinement, it has shown some fragilities, some difficulties, and some topics which were never discussed by the high management of the companies have been discussed because of the confinement. So, as an effect, there have been decisions in many companies, in our customers and ourselves, which are. To take more, to put more budget and to do more for cybersecurity. Yeah. So I would say, for what I see, for what we see, the positive effect is clearly for Airbus, the cybersecurity part is not damaged in terms of field of activity compared to the aircraft, which is much more difficult, as you know. It's completely different.
And if
you have more to do in cybersecurity, it's because your customers are more aware that there are things to do.
And did you reorientate a little bit the way you work or the directions you go through this total changement of the way that people work. So is there new stuff that you did not take into account before, or did you say now, okay, we have to put even more effort into the cyber range because this is a big project? Is there something that you can share in that direction? So how the COVID changed the directions of the cybersecurity division at Airbus?
Yes, so we have changed things. So let's be logical with what I've said since 1 hour. It's a domain where you have to adapt quickly. So CyberRange is much more used, again, as I said. But even in terms of development of parts of our R&D and so on, we made some decisions of reorientation. So because of some changes for everything, but we had to do changes. So I said we had, but it's also because we had opportunities, huh? We new fields. So typically on Orion, the malware detection tool I was speaking about, we think it's really a tool which is very important, and even more with home office extension of home office work and so on, because you have more and more risk of malware entering, where you want to have a dynamic way of testing them on a regular basis. So so we have put more efforts to develop it and new features because of this. Mm-hmm. Just a practical example.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very, very interesting. And one topic we look at the chair is also the arms race between the attackers and the defenders. And what would you say in the pandemic? Did the attackers gain more force or did the defenders gain more force?
Well, it's a tricky one, huh, because I'm not having lunch with the attackers. So, but the teams were protecting. Well, they are very good at the group of attackers, and they are more and more organized. You have probably seen, it's not only from me, but during the subgroup of attackers that we know, because we have a surveillance of more than 150 groups of attackers that our teams here in the SOC, they know them because they know their style of attack. They can recognize their style. So, and these groups were had also some trouble because of the confinement. So they changed a bit the way they were doing things. So this in detail you can notice, but also the targets have changed. But in terms of a distance between the defenders and the attackers, I think we have just to keep it as tight as possible and respect the intelligence of the attackers, because they have a lot of ideas, and that's why I think we should never think they stop inventing. And it's also a way of thinking of cyber. It's never finished.
Yeah, very good. Another question that I have is, what is the role of artificial intelligence or machine learning for cybersecurity on both sides, again, on the attack side and on the defense side? So are we seeing more machine learning-based attacks already? Is machine learning helping a lot for defending? Is it also part of the cyber range? Is it part of your attacks there?
Can you just repeat the beginning of the question? Sorry.
The beginning of the question is the role of machine learning for cybersecurity.
Intelligence artificielle in general. Yes. So, so in the SOC, here we have already, and in Orion, we have some machine learning and some intelligence artificial parts, because with the extension of the number of the volume of activity that you have to survey and detect inside small deviance, small abnormal things, you need this auto-apprentissage, of course. At the same time, what we see that we have a lot of, we still need experts. So how to say that? It's just, I could say intelligence artificielle is the answer to everything. It's the answer to, it's supporting, and it's one part of the answer. You should not neglect it. And typically, we have some specialists close to the SOC who are doing only intelligence artificielle. So in the teams, so the answer is clear, it's very important. Mm-hmm. And you have also to least for today, to have some experts close to that and mixed intelligence artificial results and the expertise.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very good, very interesting. My next question would be collaboration between companies. So obviously it makes sense to share attack data and so on in order to protect better against attacks. Would you say this is happening already in a good way, or it should be much more, or is this some interesting way to continue the development of the products? So to enable like privacy aware or company secret aware sharing of threat intelligence data, like learned attack information, sharing it with the competitor and also getting from the competitor such information, is it something that is happening? Is it something that you see will happen much more in the future?
So it's not easy to share between competitors. I will not give all the examples, but I just want to answer globally. We share much more than in other domains. And for example, so already we share the IOCs ANSI in most cases, and also with other partners, and it's organized between CERT and so on. But you know, and in addition, we have collaboration with partners for big programs. So I cannot give the names, but it's really in from you, it's the competitors of Airbus Cyber, and we work together to design especially detection tools which are really innovative.
Yeah.
And it's a kind of plateau where we do so, and I cannot give examples, but
sure.
My answer is yes, it exists, and there are places where we mix our knowledge and we develop together. Mm-hmm. So there are places for cooperation and there are places for competition.
Mm-hmm. And the chair is also one of such places for collaboration, for instance. Yeah.
Yes. Well, you'd better understand the moves and the strategy, otherwise you can lose your position.
Yes.
Very, very soon, very early.
Yeah. Yeah. So,
it's one of the interests also of the cybersecurity.
Yeah. If you
remain alone, I think you can lose quickly your position. If, for example, in our company, we have the head of innovation, for example, and of the head of engineering. Just to give an example, they are not only good in management or good in. There are people who like create new relationship with partners and so on.
Mm-hmm.
And, it's my second in line, and they are like that. The head of engineering is has pushed for the cyber since the beginning, mm-hmm. Speaking about working with academics, working with. So I think it's a way to answer. You have to compete and to partner several times with the same company in front of you in a few days.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like the answer a lot because it's like this arms race thing. So the attackers are also getting together and doing something, and it's a good idea to team up, obviously. And you can also do so. Yeah.
Of course, in my answer, I have the impression that it's every time. It's not every time. It's clear that you have to be able to do both in parallel. And mm-hmm. I discuss on a regular basis with the head of cybersecurity. Of other companies. I will not mention them because I would forget some of them.
Yeah, very good, very, very good and very interesting. What is the role of open source software, hardware for cybersecurity?
What did you say just before, hardware, software?
Open source.
Open source?
Yes.
I know that we use open source solutions, even sometimes in governmental solutions. Huh? Honestly, in some domains, they are completely the best, huh? Or at least comparable. So, again, I don't want to give names because I have some in mind, but perhaps it's not the case anymore, so I would not. But
yeah.
Typically, in in governmental solutions, there are open source paths which are selected because they are best in class.
Mm-hmm. Okay, cool. And my last question would be, it's again a very open question, maybe you can say something to it. Quantum computing. This is the big topic that is coming. Do you already look at that? What do you think will quantum computing do for cybersecurity? Will it be helpful for the attackers, for the defenders? Will it be breaking everything? What is your opinion on that?
On what? Sorry, my colleague again.
Quantum computing.
Quantum computing. First of all, as an engineer, I think quantum computing, it's just a domain where I would like to work in addition to cyber, because it's so impressive. And I hope the European players like Atos will really position Europe. Then for a quantum, when it will be there, it will change a lot of things. So it's a good news, because there are things to do. Because it will be able to crack everything, most everything. So yes, I will not elaborate more, but it's just a complete change in paradigm. And for your information, we have already more than 3 projects on quantum communications. Mm-hmm. Where we work in order to prepare the future. Mm-hmm. So it's not only words, we work already in advance.
Very good. Mm-hmm. Cool, yeah, so these were lots of super interesting questions, and I like a lot that we did the format that you did, a shorter talk, and then we had longer discussion, because it was really good and insightful. I loved it. So thank you very much for that. And thank you very much for the presentation overall. So it was a great start of the series. Wonderful.
Okay.
Maybe you stop sharing, because then I can share the slide with the overview again.
No, Marc-Olivier, I will keep doing it. No. Okay.
Okay, perfect. Good. Okay, yeah, so this was today's Talk Cyber CNI session with Frédéric Jules, and it was a blast, so I really enjoyed it. I loved it. Thanks a lot again for the cool insights, and also for the focus on this education part and on the emulation part, and also on the importance of cybersecurity. It was as I hoped. You have been the perfect start for the series. Thank you very much for that.
Thank you to you. Thank you for the questions also of the people.
Thanks. So this is already the last slide. So this is a monthly series. So we'll meet every last Wednesday in the month. That means the next event will be on the 24th of February again at 5:00. I hope you enjoyed it. We'll process the video. We'll put it online, and then you can have a look again. We also have had a summer school on security, which is under future-iot.org. There are also lots of videos. So also a colleague of Frederick, who is currently also with him, so Paul-Emmanuel Bra, he was giving a great talk there that you can have a look
at. I want to thank Paul-Emmanuel. He's the head of innovation I was speaking about in our company, so Paul-Emmanuel Bra. And also Eric Chambarot, who is the head of engineering I was speaking about just before. So just
yes. Perfect.
With names to the people.
Yeah. And it's great pleasure to work with all of them, because they are great people. So I hope that many of you will have the opportunity to do so.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you.
They will be happy. Thanks again. And this closes today's event. I'll just show the outro, and then have a great evening, everybody. And see you hopefully on the 24th. Share the information about the series, subscribe on the website, and see you in 1 month.
Cher Cyber CNI, pôle d'excellence, région Bretagne. Au revoir et à la prochaine.